नमस्ते, माय सेल्फ त्रिवेणी खुराना, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, फैकल्टी फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट बेडसाइड न्यूरोलॉजिकल असेसमेंट। न्यूरोलॉजिकल असेसमेंट डजंट जस्ट टेक प्लेस इन न्यूरो यूनिट्स। अ पेशेंट हु डजंट हैव अ न्यूरोलॉजिकल डायग्नोसिस मे ऑल्सो रिक्वायर अ न्यूरो असेसमेंट। एग्जाम्पल, पेशेंट विद निमोनिया कैन डेवलप न्यूरोलॉजिकल चेंजेस ड्यू टू हाइपोक्सिया, और पोस्ट ऑफ पेशेंट मे हैव अ न्यूरोलॉजिकल डेफिसिट्स ड्यू टू ब्लड लॉस। नो मैटर व्हाट सेटिंग यू वर्क इन, यू विल हैव टू वर्क परफॉर्म न्यूरोलॉजिकल असेसमेंट एट सम पॉइंट। द वैल्यू ऑफ सॉलिड न्यूरोलॉजिकल असेसमेंट कांट बी ओवरस्टेटेड। अ स्मॉल चेंज इन द असेसमेंट इज इंडिकेटिव ऑफ न्यूरोलॉजिकल इंजरी एंड अर्ली इंटरवेंशन कैन प्रिवेंट परमानेंट डैमेज। परफॉर्मिंग अ न्यूरोलॉजिकल असेसमेंट सेंड्स many of us into a panic. Fortunately, does not have to be the way. Now, the comprehensive assessment. A thorough neurological assessment will include assessing mental status, cranial nerves, motor, sensory function, pupillary response, reflexes, cerebellum, and vital signs. However, unless work in a neuro unit, one typically need to perform a sensory and cerebellar assessment. Also, most vital sign changes are a sign of end-stage neurological injury. Therefore, look at assessment of mental status, cranial nerves, motor function, and pupillary response. Although this isn't a comprehensive neurological examination, it will yield valuable clinical information too. Now, first, assessing mental status. Evaluating a patient's mental status includes level of consciousness, orientation, and memory, that is LOC. To assess LOC, use Glasgow Coma Scale. LOC is crucial to test because it's the first assessment to change when there is neurological injury. Should always elicit patient's best level of response for an accurate assessment of LOC. Begin with speaking patient's name in a normal tone. If he doesn't respond, say his name again in a louder tone. If patient is hearing impaired, need to document this. It shouldn't change his score. If there is still no response, gently shake patient. If still can't get a reaction, need to use painful stimulation. To do this, you can use one of the following techniques: trapezius squeeze, sternal rub, supraorbital pressure. How trapezius squeeze? Grasp and twist the muscle that runs from the back of the neck to the shoulder. Sternal rub. Make a fist, then push the broadside of fist into the sternum and press hard enough to leave a mark on patient's skin. Supraorbital pressure. Along the bone beneath the eyebrow, find an indentation near the nose. Press it with thumb. If these techniques elicit a reaction, it comes from the brain. But there is one more technique need in your. The patient who requires painful stimulus isn't following commands. Therefore, if he reacts to the painful stimuli with only one side of body, need to assess the non-reactive side too. This can be done by pressing a pencil into the cuticle of one of patient's finger. Response we'll see will be purposeful, occurring when patient pulls away from the pain. Non-purposeful, occurring when he moves in response to the pain but not in any meaningful way, including flexion posture or extension posture, or no response at all. All painful stimuli should be applied for 15 to 30 seconds. Now, other than LOC, to determine orientation, how? Ask detailed questions about patient's name, where he is, and the date. Obtain as much information as you can from the question. Example, when asking the date, also ask for the month and year. Keep in mind that hospitalized patients often know the month, but not the date or day of the week. Evaluate patient's knowledge of date and time carefully. Patients who are confused may still answer correctly enough that a disorder goes unnoticed. Once Patient who was clearly confused in conversation but confidently stated the name of the hospital each time. Halfway, he was reading the hospital's name off his roommate's sheet, which were emblems with logos. For the same reason, alternate your question with each assessment. It's important to note that when you are assessing your patient's orientation, you are also evaluating your patient's speech. Now, memory assessing. Memory is divided into three abilities: immediate memory, short-term memory, and remote memory. To assess immediate memory, give patient three unrelated words to remember, such as pencil, grape, and car. Have him repeat the words and ask him to remember them. After 5 minutes, ask him to repeat the words back to you. To assess short-term memory, ask patient to describe something that happened in the last few days. Example is to ask him what he had for breakfast, but you will want to able to verify his response. You may choose to ask about a recent significant news event or a recent holiday. Remote memory also commonly requires verification from another party. Wedding dates or children birth dates are tests of remote memory, but if you can't confirmation, you can again try to use a news event. Now moving towards assessing the cranial nerves. Cranial number 1 is olfactory. How to test olfactory nerve? By asking the patient to identify at least 2 common substances such as coffee and cinnamon. Make sure his nostrils are patent before performing this test. Cranial number 2 is optic. Test visual acuity with Snell's chart and Rosman's near vision card. Cranial number 3 is oculomotor. Cranial number 4, trochlear, and cranial number 6 is abducens. Assess these nerves together using the corneal light reflex test, 6 cardinal position of gaze, and cover-uncover test. Also, inspect the size, shape, and symmetry of patient's pupils and papillary reactions to light. Cranial number 5 is trigeminal. To assess the sensory component of the trigeminal nerve, ask patient to close eyes and then touch him with a wisp of cotton on his forehead, cheek, and jaw on each side. Next, test pain perception by touching the tip of the safety pin to the same 3 areas. Ask him to describe and compare both sensations. To test the motor component, ask him to clench his teeth while you palpate the temporal and masseter muscles. Note the strength of the muscle contraction. It should be equally bilaterally. If patient isn't alert, test his corneal reflex by lighting touching the cornea with a fine wisp of cotton. Look for the normal reaction of blinking of the eyes. Cranial number 7 is facial. To assess the sensory component, test taste by placing items with various taste on the anterior portion of patient tongue. Example, sweet, sour, and bitter. To test motor function, observe his face for symmetry at rest and while he smiles, frown, and raises his eyebrows. Then have him close both eyes tightly. Test muscle strength by attempting to open his eyes. Cranial number 8 is acoustic nerve. Assess this nerve, use Weber's test. Striking a tuning fork lightly against your hand and place the vibrating fork on your patient's forehead at the midline or on the top of his head. And the second one is Rinne's test by striking the tuning fork against your hand and place the vibrating fork over his mastoid process. Cranial number 9 is glossopharyngeal and cranial number 10 is vagus. Test these nerves together because their innervation overlaps in the pharynx. Listen to your patient's voice, then check his gag reflex by touching the tip of a tongue blade against his posterior pharynx and asking him to open wide and say ah. Watch for symmetrical upward movement of the soft palate and uvula and for the midline position of uvula. Cranial number 11 is spinal accessory nerve. Assesses this nerve by testing the strength of the sternocleidomastoid and upper portion of trapezius. And last, cranial number 12 is hypoglossal nerve. Observe your patient's tongue for symmetry. His tongue should be midline without tremors or muscle twitching. Test tongue strength by asking him to push his tongue against his cheek as you apply resistance. Now moving towards assessing motor functions. When assessing motor function, you want to look at both sides of your patient's body simultaneously. On inspection, note any asymmetry of muscle, unilateral atrophy will often indicate weakness. To assess the upper extremities, have your patient raise his arms parallel to the floor or bed, and then have him resist when you are trying to push them down. You will do the same for the lower extremities, having him raise his legs and resist when you push them down. You can also have him grasp your finger in his fist and then ask him to let go. If he can't let go on command, it's indicative of neurological injury. To test for pronated drift, have your patient close his eyes so he can't compensate and extend his arms palm up and in front of him. Look for one arm to sway from its original position, a subtle indicator of weakness. Now, assessing pupillary response. Along with eye motion, pupillary response is controlled by cranial number 3, 4 and 6. Normal pupils are of same size, bilaterally about 2 to 6 mm and round. About 15% of people have one pupil up to 1 mm smaller than the other. This is a normal variant known as an isochoria. To check pupillary activity, bring a small beam of light in from outer canthus of the one eye. The normal response is for both pupils to react equally and briskly. Keep in mind that medication, surgery and blindness can affect pupil size, shape and reactivity. The hallmark sign of severe neurological injury is the change in pupil size and reactivity. Eye motion is tested by asking patient to follow your fingers as you trace the letter H in front of him. This is known as extraocular movement. Document any inability to follow your finger. Now, what is a focused assessment? Although a thorough neurological assessment yields valuable information, at times you will need to perform a focused neurological assessment. You may have a patient with a neurological diagnosis who develops a change. More likely, you may have a patient with another diagnosis who develops a neurological deficit. In these cases, it isn't necessary to perform the entire assessment as previously described. Limit your examination to LOC, motor strength and pupillary reactivity. You also want to include other assessments you feel may yield important data. Example, if your patient develops slurred speech, you will want to include an examination of cranial nerves involved with speech. Now follow these steps to perform a successful neurological assessment. These are: keep a cheat sheet remembering the function of each cranial nerve, or the terminology to describe deficits is overwhelming. Consult your cheat sheet for accurate documentation or when discussing your findings with the healthcare provider, as well as to determine what additions you need if you perform a focused neurological assessment. Explain the assessment to your patient and his family before you begin. Many people are frightened when they or a loved one develop a neurological injury, so they can become frustrated when you ask them to do such seemingly silly things as sticking out their tongues. Explain to your patient upfront that you will be asking him to answer a series of questions and perform commands that may seem trivial but are important indicators of brain function. Also instruct family members not to answer questions for the patient even if he seems to be struggling to respond. Peak performance. Performing a neurological assessment can be scary, but if you take your time and use the proper resources, you can perform a solid neurological assessment no matter what. So, during bedside assessment, one should assess comprehensive assessment, in which assessing mental status, cranial nerve assessment, motor nerve motor functions, sensory functions, pupillary response, reflexes, cerebellum, एंड वाइटल साइंस. थैंक यू.